Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about electrolytes.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Anyone who is a fan of sports beverages has heard of the word electrolyte before. But what does this word really mean? This term refers to a substance that, when dissolved in water, will dissociate into positively charged and negatively charged ions, which have the ability to conduct electricity in solution. A substance that will not dissociate into ions when dissolved in water will not be able to conduct electricity and is therefore called a non-electrolyte. The greater the extent to which a substance dissociates, the stronger an electrolyte it is. So as we look at different types of electrolytes, we will be focusing on the efficiency of the dissociation. If a substance completely dissociates in solution, it is a strong electrolyte and will conduct electricity very well. If a substance only partially ionizes in solution, meaning some particles dissociate and some do not, this will be called a weak electrolyte, which will still conduct electricity, but not as well as a strong electrolyte. And as we said, a substance that does not dissociate at all will be a non-electrolyte. We can categorize substances as being one of these three things by measuring the electrical conductance of their corresponding aqueous solutions. In order to conduct electricity, a substance must contain freely mobile charged species, such as the case with metallic wires, which allow for the free movement of electrons. In a solution, these freely mobile charged species are the ions that result when a substance dissociates. The more ions there are in solution, the greater the conductivity and the stronger the electrolyte. And we can measure the current flow or simply observe the brightness of a light bulb included in the circuit to gather this kind of data. Let's categorize electrolytes a bit further. Something like potassium chloride will dissociate entirely, so it is a strong electrolyte. It is also an example of an ionic electrolyte. These are ionic compounds that will dissociate in aqueous solution to give individual cations and anions. The dissolution occurs because the cations and anions will be able to make ion-dipole interactions with the water molecules that comprise the solvent. And this energy storage, combined with the greater disorder of the solution over a crystallized ionic solid, is what results in spontaneous dissociation. The ions will therefore be dispersed throughout the solution in order to maximize solvation, that is, to maximize the ion-dipole interactions that are occurring, by allowing for as many water molecules to interact with each individual ion as possible. This will be the case with most ionic solids, which is why ionic solids, whether comprised of monoatomic ions or polyatomic ions, tend to be strong electrolytes. Acetic acid, being a weak acid, will only partially dissociate, so it is a weak electrolyte. This is also an example of a covalent electrolyte, because the molecule contains strictly covalent bonds, and unlike ionic solids that allow their interionic attractions to dissipate in favor of solvation, these covalent species undergo an actual chemical reaction with the solvent molecules in solution to form charged products. These will typically be strong acids and bases that either donate a proton to a water molecule or remove a proton from a water molecule. For example, hydrogen chloride is a covalent compound. There are no formally charged particles in this substance, only neutral atoms. But when dissolved in water, it will become hydrochloric acid, which is a strong acid, and will completely transfer all of its protons to water molecules, resulting in a certain amount of hydronium ions and chloride ions. This means there will be enough ions in solution for it to be considered a strong electrolyte, so it will conduct electricity. Of course, the identity of the solvent plays a big part in this, as in order for hydrochloric acid to donate a proton, something must accept that proton. So, if hydrochloric acid were to be placed in an aprotic solvent like ether or hexanes, this would not result in an electrolytic solution, as these solvents can't accept any protons the way a water molecule can. But for aqueous solutions, let's keep in mind that strong acids and bases will be strong electrolytes because they ionize completely in solution, whereas weak acids and bases, like acetic acid, will only partially ionize and will therefore be weak electrolytes, as they will generate relatively small concentrations of ions in solution. Lastly, something like ethanol won't dissociate almost at all, so it won't generate any current, making it a non-electrolyte. That's because it doesn't have appreciable acidity or basicity, so the reactions it will make with water molecules in solution will be negligible. The same can be said for sugar and many other covalent compounds, or water-insoluble ionic compounds. We want to make sure we can identify substances as being strong electrolytes, weak electrolytes, or non-electrolytes, so let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.